Welcome, LA Progressive friends and family. Dick and I are joined today again with Henry Giroux. And Henry currently holds the McMaster University Chair for Scholarship in the Public Interest in the English and Cultural Studies Department and is the Paulo Freire Distinguished Scholar in Critical Pedagogy. His most recent books include The Terror of Unforeseen, On Critical Pedagogy, second edition, Race, Politics, and Pandemic Pedagogy, Education in a Time of Crisis. Now that's a mouthful. And several others. Welcome, Henry.
Oh, it's so thank you so much for inviting me. It's always a pleasure.
Yeah, so for the audience, we're Dick and Sharon from LA Progressive, and most happy to be talking to a person who's become, I would say, quite a good friend here, Henry Giroux. So recently you wrote a really long and involved article called Paulo Freire's Legacy and the Necessity of Critical Pedagogy in Dark Times. And you talk about that you had a personal collegial relationship with him over many years. Can you describe that?
Yeah, I met Paulo in 1980. He came to the U.S. and I was at that time teaching at Boston University. He was around 40. No, he was much older. He was older. But I had just been denied tenure by John Silber, who was a right wing, a notorious right wing educator. And Paulo came, and I invited him to BU, and we talked about all of that. And it was clear that Paulo's I wanted to do everything I could at that time to sort of distribute Paulo's work all over the United States. Other people had been doing it, of course. Ira Shaw was actively involved in doing it, among others. And Paulo and I decided that we were going to put together a series for Bergen and Gavi, who no longer exist. The series is gone. But at that time, we basically began a collaboration that lasted until he died. He was going back to Brazil at that point. There was talk of him going back. He had been in exile for 20 years. He was an enormously beautiful, humble man. His wife, you know, the end of his life, that died. It was a very tough period for him. We were constantly in collaboration. And then he met another woman, and the last 10 years of his life were filled with enormous joy. I mean, I have to tell you one story. At that period in his life, I remember we were sitting down before, we were both about to give a talk, and he was going to go first. And, you know, I was always the second act. But he says, you know, he called me Giroux. He says, Giroux. He says, every talk I give, I start with love. And it was true. I mean, he was somehow invoked the question of love and turned it into a pedagogical category, of course. That was just incredible. But he was a very powerful mentor for me. He made clear what it meant to be humble, what it meant to be engaged, what it meant to have a sense of one's own history, and what it meant to be courageous. I mean, he was an enormously courageous man. He was an incredible speaker, incredible. He was really one of the first public intellectuals that I met that convinced me that you could be rigorous and accessible and warm and humble at the same time. Stanley Aronowitz, I had seen before him, he did that. William Kunstler, the lawyer, did that. Dick Gregory, the comedian, did that. I saw them all within a span of 5 years before I met Paulo. And that convinced me that you didn't have to come from an elite university to talk to people, you know, or talk in a language that nobody understood.
Wow. You have had some interactions with some very powerful, big minds. I'm jealous. So I had never heard of Paulo until my daughter went to college and she began dating a young man who really idolized Paulo's work. And I'm avoiding saying Paulo Freire.
Yeah.
Is that it? Do I have it right?
Yes.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, it could be Paulo Freire. It's whichever, you know.
So anyway, so because my daughter's boyfriend, who by the way is now her husband and has been her husband, they've been together for 20 years, because he idolized him, I looked him up and I bought Pedagogy of the Oppressed and read it, and just I had not read him before, but I come to the same conclusions, on my own, of course, not as brilliant, as in depth, but immediately I could read what he was saying, see what he was saying, and already saw that if we do not have an educated populace, we're doomed.
Yeah, I mean, I when Dick asked me the earlier question about how I got to know him, there really is a background story to that, Dick, that I think is enormously relevant and ties in exactly with what Sharon is saying. I was a high school teacher for about 6 years, and this was in the 70s. And there was a vice principal who once came by my door, who was it was an ex-army officer, so you can imagine how he felt about education. And I had the students in a circle. And he knocked on the door and he said, "Why are you doing this?" He said, "This, put them in rows, line them up. This is really kind of a militarized operation." And to be honest with you, at that time, I really couldn't explain theoretically why I was doing what I was doing. I could say I like students, I think they should talk, all this stuff. It wasn't enough. Ironically, about 3 days before, somebody had sent me Pedagogy of the Oppressed. I read the book and it changed my life. All of a sudden, I felt that Paulo had given me a language that I could use, which I think is what is indirectly maybe what Sharon is
That is
saying.
it,
He
yes.
gave me a language about power, about education, about context, about banking education. I then was asked to write a review for an article he wrote and had submitted to a Canadian academic journal. Interchange was the name. Ironically enough, I'm at BU, I'm having trouble with my dean, and I get a letter from Paulo saying that this was just a fabulous article. He can't wait to talk to me. My chair immediately took it to the dean, and they rehired me until I later got fired. So that was a kind of the backstory to Paulo until I then met him. And it was because we had corresponded because of the interchange over the letter, then met him, and along with Donaldo Macedo, my dear brother, who was his translator for the next 30 years, and even more. That's how that relationship began. But I think that what both Paulo, I, and Donaldo saw and agreed upon was this question of literacy and the question of language and how liberating language can be. When it's not just a technique, when it's not just a skill, when it's really about not just reading the word, but reading the world, and how those two issues have to be connected. I don't know if you saw the recent talk by J.D. Vance, where they were focusing on his comments on education. And he gets up, and the first thing he says to this conservative group, which is not unrelated to what we're talking about, is that professors are the enemy. They're the enemy. Higher education is the enemy. It's a cesspool of woke, left Marxism, leftism, Marxism, communism, all those sort of things. This was exactly the language, by the way, that was used by the junta in 1964 to exile Paulo because of the fact that he was waging a literacy campaign in the countryside, and it had become enormously public because it was working. All of a sudden, peasants were able to narrate themselves outside of the internalization of oppression that had its own language that was self-destructive and would sabotage their sense of themselves, their relationship to others, and the world. It was dangerous. Like Herat has said, thinking is dangerous, and Paulo understood this.
So, in the current day, I mean, part of what is going on here is academic freedom and revolutionary academic freedom. And in the current moment, it seems like we're losing the battle in that in some places it's against the law to teach about slavery, to teach Black history, to demonize critical race theory. How do you see that? How do you see that battle going? And then in my mind, another attack on on education is the fact that tuition has become so high that it scares a lot of working class kids away. So how do you see that battle between what that military officer saw as education and what Paulo Freire might have seen?
I think there are three things that come to mind that are enormously important. I think that, first of all, what the right understands is that ideas matter, and that we have to do everything we can to shut those ideas down that are seen as particularly dangerous, that give people a sense of agency, a sense of empowerment, and a sense of critique, that in other words, expand the narrative of critical agency. Secondly, they understand that the institutions that produce those ideas are equally dangerous, because they often have a democratic mission, regardless of how simply liberal they might be, that they operate off the assumption an informed citizen is a critical citizen. Thirdly, it seems to me, there are two forms of oppression at work trying to undermine public education as a democratic public sphere, both public education and higher education. And what those two forms have been around and employed by the right for a long time. One is an ideological war, and that's a war that can be very crude, and it's very crude now. It's a war that often says people who are engaged in dissent are either anti-Semitic or they're communist or they're Marxist, the ideological boogeymen, right? We've heard this for years, and it predates McCarthyism. I mean, Rachel Maddow, to her great, it seems to me, courage, has had a longstanding series of programs where she's traced the attack on higher education by communists, by right-wingers in the 20s. Yeah. Trying to shut down, literally shut down universities, saying the communists are after your kids, right? And then tracing that, of course, in the McCarthy period and then the 70s. When I was at BU in the 70s, they were putting online the names of what so-called communist professors. And, they were using the social media to do that. And I think that that's the first argument. The second argument is to defund public education and call it and higher education and call it government education. Make the argument that these institutions are dangerous. Are you ready? Because they're the enemy of the market. The ideological argument says that they're the enemy of what they would call right wing ideology. Right, you have to be a right winger and not a communist. In other words, the enemy friend distinction is in full bloom here and has been for years. If you're on the left, if you're critical, you're the enemy. And what do you do with the enemy? You get rid of them. I mean, I don't know if you remember Liz Cheney. Liz Cheney's mother. When she was head of the humanities, and after 2011, 9/11 rather, all of a sudden anybody who criticized the United States was a terrorist. That was a terrible period in higher education. But this is worse. This is worse because the war that's being waged now ideologically is being waged by billionaires. It's being waged by a corporate media that has an enormous reach. It's being waged not only at the level in which the social media becomes a powerful corporate cultural apparatus, but these people are now mobilizing to take over schools. They're on school boards. Right. They're banning books at the public school level. Now there's a great attempt to push back, and that's fabulous. And actually, they're winning. The pushback is actually very encouraging. Moms for Liberty, their influence is waning because they're extremists. They're right-wing extremists. They're neo-Nazis. And I, at the other level, with the war in Israel, of course, the war Israel is waging against Gaza, Lebanon, and now eventually the entire Middle East, probably, there's a new way in which language is being shut down. And that is the language of critique, particularly if it embraces a notion of freedom that's associated with what we might call traditional disposable populations, Black, brown, young, working class, young people, Palestinians. There's an attempt to shut down any form of critique that encourages a notion of freedom that is in some way an argument against global capitalism. Not just war, global capitalism, right? When you get Jared Kushner talking about beachfront property on Gaza, right? Or you get right wingers, are you ready for this, saying the universities should be shut down because the land that universities often inhabit in cities is beautiful. We should turn that land over to the developers. So what you've got to understand here is you don't have just a right-wing ideological argument about the evils of socialism, right, and those who advocate it. You also have a far-right global neoliberal argument that wants to privatize everything.
Right.
And schools are now the essential site of struggle because they are the essential public good. The punishing state has already criminalized a whole range of social problems, haven't they? From poverty to homelessness to the social services. Ask yourself what institutions are left. And what's left is higher education. For all of its flaws, for all of its corporatization, there are spaces there that are dangerous. Not only that, you have a generation of students, these unbelievably brave students who remind me of the 60s, you know, who are now losing potential jobs, speaking out, being banished. I mean, universities saying you're persona non grata. You can't come on the campus because what? You're fighting for the justice? You're fighting for justice against the elimination of an entire people? I mean,
right.
You know, and it's international. I mean, that's where this struggle against education becomes so important. During my lifetime, it was difficult to turn this into an international movement. You had the revolts in May in 68 in the United States and in Europe, but they weren't integrated the way they are today. Students are learning from each other, and they're realizing that this death machine propelled by neoliberalism should not be in the university.
So before you go any further, I want to expound upon a couple of terms that you're using, one of which is neoliberalism. But I want to also put a real spotlight on the word critical, because it appears to me that there is a movement that is anti-critical thinking, anti-critical pedagogy, anti-critical race theory. And the reason I want to put a spotlight on that is because there can be a tendency to think that just using the word critical in and of itself is a bad thing, and that it means to tear down. So I want you to, for those of us who have not been to university, I know many people that are like that, who, when we're speaking with these terms, neoliberalism, critical pedagogy, why is it that the right feels that critical thinking is dangerous? Because we know that it's dangerous to them, but it's actually beneficial to us. But what? So let's go back to just the term critical and critiquing.
I mean, you know, I'll tell you a personal story that opens up the discussion that I want to amplify. It'll take 10 seconds. When I was at Penn State, Jonathan Kozel, I don't know if you know
yes,
Jonathan.
Yes, yes, yes.
He's a good friend, right? You know, I grew up with him in Boston. And he came to Penn State to give a talk, and we were talking to a dean at that time who was really a guy whose mind was unburdened by a complicated thought. And Jonathan said something like, well, you know, were you actively involved in Boston in the study in the movement against racial segregation? He said, you know, was there a critical discourse around which you work? And the guy said, critical? That's negativism.
Right.
And I think in some kind of very subtle way, you understand where we're going here, that there's a way in which the right attaches to the word critical, not just simply this belief, facetious notion of negativism, but it's also an attack on other things. It's an attack on patriotism. It's an attack on the government. It seems to suggest something treasonous. It seems to suggest that you're out of bounds. You know, you're not operating within the confines of, are you ready? Common sense, right? To be critical is to be disruptive. It's to in some way, you know, stop the music. You know, nobody's dancing anymore because of you. So there's this utterly negative association attached to critical, anything critical. But there's also a sense of how you dehumanize people and objectivize them by virtue of being critical. Now, let's take this a step further. The other side of this is you have a press, a corporate press, that corporate control press, that really in some ways believes the same thing. You can't do a fact check when you're interviewing a presidential candidate. What? When they're lying, and when
Mm-hmm.
they're lying and saying that the election was won by Trump when it wasn't, J.D. Vance, you can't, you operate off the assumption that you have to have both sides. Well, I don't know if there's a discussion about a presidential candidate who's basically a fascist. He's not a normal candidate. And what's at stake here? Truth is at stake. So the whole notion of objectification, balance, both sidism is really informed by, if I may say this, an enormous distrust of what it means to be critical. And I'll give you the ultimate definition: to think in a way in which you can hold power accountable, to think in a way in which you learn how to govern and not be governed, to think in a way in which you have an understanding, a critical understanding of your place in the world, your relationship to others, and you understand larger, wider global forces. In other words, you can't disassociate critical from the question of power. And you can't disassociate, and this for me is really the issue that guides my life. You cannot disassociate critical from a sense of social responsibility.
Love it. Love it. So, in my mind, the way that I would define it, say I'm talking to my fourth grade granddaughter, I would say that being critical simply means questioning authority. Not just relying on rote memorization when you go to school, but expand, broaden your horizons, and look at various ways to think, and don't just rely on someone to tell you how to think.
I think that's fabulous. I mean, as a matter of fact, central to Paulo's work, since we're talking about Paulo, was a long-standing emphasis on students should be able to ask questions. They should exist in a place where the imagination all of a sudden becomes a gift rather than an act of repression, right? Or is subject to repression. That a culture of questioning is really central to what it means not to freeze one's own sense of history, not to freeze one's introduction to knowledge, not to find oneself in a place so frozen that there are no choices, there are no alternatives, and there's no sense of what the constraints are that limit those choices. So it seems to me, in the most fundamental way, the notion of critical is really about imagining a future that doesn't simply replicate the present. It always has a sense of hope, educated hope, assigned to it, because it says there's more. And it says that no society is really ever just enough, ever just enough. It has the lyrics of poetry. It's not about origins, it's about journeys. It's about power. It's about compassion. It's about justice. All the things that the neo-Nazis hate today. And I use I don't I'm, I'm I have to tell your audience, I have no apologies for using the word neo-Nazis, because it seems to me if you can't recognize how fascist elements are unfolding in the United States and Turkey and Hungary and Italy and Argentina, you can't learn from history. And that what critical thinking, I would think one fundamental element is to learn from history and to learn the injustices that have gone on and how they can be overcome, and to learn about resistance movements that have affected women, LGBTQ people, to learn about rights, how they evolved and how they get repressed. That's the element of what it means to be critical, is to be alive. To be critical, as my friend bell hooks used to say, is to talk back, to learn to talk back.
You've had some
Be,
great.
to be, you know, I have in my books, particularly a new one coming out called Theory and Resistance, which was written actually in 1980, but they're republishing it now at Bloomsbury. And I have a sentence that I love that dates me. To be critical, you have to make something critical, meaningful in order to make it critical, in order to make it transformative. I'll say it again, and then I'll tell you why, if I may.
Yes.
Meaningful, to be critical, to be transformed. First of all, it has to be contextual. What your critical pedagogy in some way is fundamental to recognizing kids come with stories. They come with histories. They come with experiences. If you find yourself in an educational setting in which what's going on is no relationship to where you come from, who you are, and what you believe in, it's not meaningful. When I went to school as a kid, I grew up in a working class neighborhood, lots of union people. They talked about the wobblies. How's that one? They talk about the unions. I go to school, and all of a sudden, we're talking about white men, making history. Isolated white men, no history. Imagine what that meant for women. Imagine what that meant for blacks. And imagine that if we can laugh and say that's a historical moment, but you have a governor in Florida who is saying that kids should not learn about slavery because it makes white kids uncomfortable. I mean, or Nikki Haley, sort of suggesting that slavery was really about states' rights. Yes, it was. It was about reproducing slavery. And so this attack on history that we see really nullifies any viable notion of the critical that includes a sense of historical consciousness.
Yeah. So as a black kid sitting in those classrooms in the 60s, when I'd open up a history book or a social studies book and only see white faces, now there were two, at least two experiences of what that was for a black kid. In some instances, some black kids interpreted that to mean that black people made no contributions. Then in some instances, and I'm the second instance, I looked at the book and I said, oh, this is a bunch of bullshit. Because there's no possible way that I can believe that the people that I know, that I come from, made no contribution. So we've been excluded, and I believed at that time, even in the fourth grade, I believed the exclusion was intentional.
Oh, no, it was systemic. Not only intentions, it's systemic, right? I mean, what we see happening today is a signpost, a mirror of what had happened historically right after slavery. I mean, what we're seeing is Jim Crow being put in a business suit. Jim Crow is not some cracker, in the South, right, spewing all this racist nonsense. Jim Crow now sits in a tower in New York City and is the head of a hedge fund. And I think that to be what we need are wider kinds of historical and theoretical lens that inform what it means to be critical, that opens up those possibilities. And let's be clear, when we talk about critical race theory, when we talk about black history, when we talk about radical education, all of that, when we talk about women's liberation, when we talk about the history of the LGBTQ movement, all of these movements have one thing in common. They're transformative and they challenge power, dominant forms of power. And so to be critical is an easy term to use to smear them in a way to suggest that they're just disruptive. These are disruptive people, right? And they talk too loud, they get in the way.
And they hate America.
They hate America. They stop traffic. They walk out of classes. They don't eat the right foods. And they're not shopping in, high-end stores. I mean, really?
So go ahead, honey. I've been interrupting you. Dick's been wanting to get in, and I've been.
Oh, well, the one thing I said, you said that the pushback against these right-wing efforts to disembowel education or make it into training for workers are successful, have been successful. Well, what's going on that we don't, Sharon and I don't know about?
Well, I think that first of all, there at three levels we see something happening. First of all, take the youth movements, right? There are youth movements all across the United States at public and higher education. At public higher education, youth are mobilizing, walking out of schools and stopping them from functioning around the question of gun violence. These are national movements. And these kids now are essentially connecting this critique of gun violence to systemic violence that operates at multiple levels. This is an important movement. It doesn't get a lot of press for obvious reasons. I think that the current attacks on higher education being waged by the right, particularly around shutting down freedom of speech, has become a global issue. And I think that when we see as if you see educators being fired, I think what we're beginning to see is that a recognition that for faculty to survive in this current climate, they have to be like the United Auto Workers. They have to do what the dock workers have just done. They've got to unite and they've got to shut these institutions down for a day or for a week, that we need cataclysmic movements that make visible in a profound way the kinds of injustices that the press cannot ignore. cannot ignore. That's the second issue. Thirdly, I have to tell you, I've been writing about critical pedagogy and certainly fascism for 40 years. I have never seen this movement be so international and broad-based as it is today. When I put the Paulo Freire piece that for you on Twitter, it got 9,000 hits
Wow.
in something like 5 hours.
Wow.
And I think that's, as my wife Rania would say, anything you write about education is hot, it's hot food. It just spreads like wildfire because it's an issue everybody understands, most people understand, is under siege.
Right.
When these morons like Trump say things like, oh, they're all leftists, they're communists, he gets confused. He says, they're communists and they're Nazis. Okay. I'm sorry, Donald. Or we hate the professors, or we hate education, or the Moms for Liberty say, we're going to ban Toni Morrison, right, from the high school and children's books from that celebrate Black history from the elementary schools. It's too obvious. So there is a growing literacy movement in this country that I think is profoundly potential in terms of how it's organizing people. Dick, to put it another way, I think the level of repression and the language used to support it has tipped over to a point where people can't look away anymore. They can't look away. And I think that given the encouragement we've seen from youth movements, from the LGBTQ movement, the Black Lives Matter movement, and a whole range of movements, I don't know. I'm hopeful. I'm optimistic.
So one of the things that concerns me, and maybe you've looked into this and you think about this, is each of those movements that you've talked about, they almost operate in silos. They're with like-minded people. Dick and I saw a documentary that was aired at our local college, Occidental College, called War Games, where they talked about a 2025 event that's similar to January 26th. January 6th. And the whole thesis of this documentary is that it's approaching time for the new president to be inaugurated. And there are people that are in the military who have become part of the far right. And they are helping with another January 6th type insurrection. And they're not obeying the powers that be. So my concern is with this security industrial complex, the police, the paramilitary, the border control, private security, all of these forces typically are not seen as part of the other movements that you're talking about. And these guys are armed.
I mean,
So,
I think,
yeah.
yeah, sorry.
Go
No,
ahead. No,
done.
you see where I'm headed.
No. I think that one of the, yeah, let me intervene in that question in two or three ways. One is you have a movement that basically is about the collapse of the social state, right? And what that means at every level, public schools need to be eliminated, Social Security needs to be eliminated, anything that provides a social provision. So the question then becomes, what happens? Well, what happens in these countries is that when the social state collapses, the punishing state emerges.
That's right.
And social problems are now criminalized. But to be criminalized, you have to organize the apparatus, the military industrial security apparatuses, including the defense industries, right? In ways that coordinate their efforts to basically not just shut down emancipatory movements, regardless of where they begin. But globally, it's a global movement, right? And it represents the merging of private interest and the corporate state. The military industrial complex is now much, much more powerful than it's ever been in the past. Now, the other side of that is that, and if I'm reading you correctly, Sharon, one side of that is to recognize how they coordinate together various interests in order to create a punishing and repressive apparatus that cannot be ignored. It can't be ignored, right? Now the prison becomes the model for everything, right? Not the schools, the social services. The other side of this is that the left has to basically come together in ways that refuses to trap themselves in silos that prevent them from creating a mass movement. We've got to bring these overlapping overlapping forms of repression, whether gender, race, sexual violence, together into one mass movement. They've got to join with unions, and they've got to basically create the possibility for not only talking to each other and acting in ways in which a larger movement is possible, but also can project an alternative for a third party, a party that is anti-capitalist, that operates outside of the corporate logic, in which reform becomes the only possible language that people have. I mean, we need a wider theoretical lens, and a wider understanding of politics, and we need to bring these movements together. They can't exist as isolated movements because they're not powerful enough. And not only that, they're inadequate theoretically. You can't talk about race without talking about class. You can't talk about the attack of the LGBTQ movement without talking about global capitalism. You can't talk about the destruction of public schools, for instance, take Dick's argument by being defunded. I'm sorry, you can't talk about public schools failing because kids are stupid without looking at the way in which they're defunded by the corporate state and designed to fail. You can't do it, you know? So it seems to me that all of these things are crucial. But my friend Stanley Aronowitz said three things about this. He said, one, you've got to invent a language that embraces the radical imagination, meaning we have got to talk about radical and socialist democracy. That has to be the narrative that brings these movements together. For instance, you can't be for women's reproductive rights and be a racist. Sorry, it doesn't work. You know, you can't be in an LGBTQ movement and say capitalism is okay, like Robert Reich does. You know, you can't do it. It doesn't work. So that's the first thing. Secondly, we need to create educational apparatuses that basically can wage this war on the cultural front. The cultural front is the most powerful pedagogical force on the planet today, not public schools and not higher education. As crucial as they are as institutions, these cultural apparatuses that named by C. Wright Mills as such, cultural apparatuses. We have got to find a way to in some way be able to challenge them. And that means we have to start educating young people not to be simply critics, not to simply be able to criticize the culture. They've got to become cultural producers.
Instead of
They've got to
consuming.
be cultural producers. They've got to know how to produce radio programs like this. They've got to know how to use this technology in their interest to fight against injustice and to educate people. Thirdly, there's got to be an alternative party. There's got to be an alternative party. Yeah. I mean, demonstrations are fine, you know, but they're not enough. They're pedagogical forms. They disappear.
That's right.
When, you know, when they're over, a movement isn't left. You need movements that are organized, institutional. You know, look, take the right-wing evangelical church. They did something that the left doesn't get. They didn't just invite people into the church. They said, we're going to offer you daycare and childcare. We're going to offer you free food.
And
We're
schools.
going to have dances. Remember what the Nazis did? The picnics, you know, the youth clubs, you know, mobilizing people around big festivals and rallies. I mean, Hitler's rallies were as much about aesthetics and about a feeling of bringing people together in a sense of community. And this is the last issue. The last issue is neoliberalism, which I had mentioned to you earlier, does three things that are lethal. One, it says that self-interest is the only interest that matters. Secondly, it divorces economic activity from social cause, from social responsibility. And thirdly, it says all problems are individual problems. That's a formula for social death. That's a formula for depoliticization. And I think in some way, we need to reclaim a language about the radical imagination that points to the value of the social, that points to the notion of justice, that embraces social responsibility and tries in some fundamental way to create a mass movement in which the auto workers, the unions, the dock workers, the educators work together in order to fight a system that has a head that has to be cut off. It has to be cut off. Capitalism is an evil system. It's as bad as what we saw in the Middle Ages with the divine right of kings. But remember, everybody thought the divine right of kings would never end. Now we have
Right now, we have
the
the divine right of capital.
divine right of capital.
So, Henry, it's been another great hour.
Absolutely.
Of how long we've been talking. We'll pick this conversation up again very soon. It's always educational, and our readers and listeners love to hear from you. This is Dick and Sharon of LA Progressive. We've spent some time with Henry Giroux, and we started talking about Paulo Freire. Today, but we expanded that conversation into many different tributaries, and we love doing that with you, Henry, and looking forward to doing it again sometime soon.
Thank you so much for the opportunity. I really appreciate it.
All righty.